What's up, guys, and welcome back. In the previous video, we got introduced to the shadow mapping technique for the rendering of, shadows. We've used the spotlight as the light source because this is the simplest type of light to implement. Now let's jump right into the next type of light, which is a directional light. Before we begin, I just want to say that I'm going to assume that you are familiar with the basics of shadow mapping. If you haven't seen the previous video, make sure to watch it right now. Check out the link in the video description below. Alright, so the reason that the spotlight is the simplest type of light when it comes to shadow mapping is because we can use perspective projection when generating the shadow map. We move the spotlight to the origin of the coordinate system and we rotate the world around it so that the spotlight ends up looking down along the z-axis. It can be the negative or positive z-axis, depending on whether you're using a right or left-handed coordinate system. I'm using a left-handed system, but it doesn't really matter as long as you are consistent throughout your application. I will show you later how to switch between the two systems. Once the spotlight is in the designated position, we use a perspective projection matrix to project the objects on the near plane of the view frustum and to transform the z-coordinate into what is going to be written to the depth buffer after viewport mapping. Perspective projection works perfectly here because it makes sure that all the pixels along the ray from the camera, or in this case the spotlight, end up in the same location on the near plane. The difference between a spotlight and a directional light is that a directional light has no position. It simply floods the entire scene with light that goes along the direction that you set. We usually use a single directional light to represent the sun, so the direction vector will simply rotate around based on the imaginary location of the sun in our 3D scene. How does it affect shadow mapping? Well, we can still create a view matrix which will rotate the world so that the light direction vector will be parallel to the z-axis, same as the spotlight. But we can't use perspective projection to generate the depth of the closest pixels because the rays do not converge to a specific point. Indeed, even the viewing area changes from a chopped-off pyramid to a simple box. Same as with the regular view frustum, this box also has a near and far planes, as well as left, right, top and bottom planes. Projecting the vertices in that box on the near plane is very simple. We just need to draw a vector which is parallel to the four sides of the box and perpendicular to the near and far planes. This means that the projected vertex maintains its x and y coordinates, and we only need to transform the z to represent the relative depth of the vertex within the box. This way, assuming that the depth test is enabled, we will still see only the closest pixels. This type of projection is called an orthographic projection. Let's see it in action in Blender. Let's take the default cube and scale it so that the far end appears to be much smaller as in the real world. We can see this more clearly if we change to wireframe. Blender currently uses a perspective projection to render the object. We can switch to an orthographic projection by clicking on 5 in the numpad. Now the two ends of the box appears to be of the same size and the image has lost its sense of depth, so it doesn't look real anymore. Orthographic projection is very useful in specific applications such as technical diagrams, computer-aided design, and also interior design, where you just want to look at a slice of the object without the effect of the 3D depth. And of course, it is useful to us here in order to generate a shadow map of a directional light. So it seems like we need a new type of a projection matrix. The job of this matrix is to map any arbitrary box to the normalized box of -1:1 that the rasterizer is using. Remember that this box is our view volume. Everything inside will be rendered and everything outside will be clipped away. We can use a larger box if we want to, kind of zoom out and get more stuff into the scene, but this means that everything will be smaller and with lower resolution. Or we can use a smaller box to zoom in and see less stuff with a higher resolution. The same goes with the directional light. A larger box will get more objects into the shadow map, but the resolution will be lower and the shadow will be blockier. We can create a better looking shadow with a smaller box, but then we may miss some of the objects. In general, we need to make the view volume of the orthographic projection as tight as possible on what is actually viewable to get the best results. In one of the upcoming videos, we will learn an algorithm for it. In order to calculate the orthographic projection matrix, we assume that we've already applied a rotation that makes the view or the light vector parallel to the z-axis. This means that the faces of the view volume are parallel to their respective planes. So we can simply specify each face as an offset from the origin on one of the axes. The left and right will be specified using an offset on the x-axis, the top and bottom on the y-axis, and the near and far on the z-axis. The next step is to map the range between each pair of faces to the range of minus 1 to 1. This is a simple case of linear mapping between two ranges. Let's say that we want to map point P in the range AB to point Q in the range CD. First, we make the range AB zero-based by subtracting A. So now we have point P minus A in the range 0 to B minus A. Next, we scale the source range to the target range by creating a ratio of D minus C divided by B minus A. The two ranges are now of the same size. Of course, P minus A is also scaled by this ratio, and we add C to translate the source range to the starting position of the target range. Using this knowledge, let's calculate the transformation of X in view space. The source range is L to R, short for left to right, and the target range is NDC space, which is minus 1 to 1. Plug this in the general equation and we get minus 1 plus X view minus L divided by R minus L times 2. We want to turn this into a matrix, so it's better if we can express it as a multiplication of X view by a factor and add an offset. Let's multiply the elements of the numerator by 2 and bring in the minus 1 to the numerator as well. So the final transformation is to multiply X view by 2 divided by R minus L, and the offset is minus R minus L divided by R minus L. The transformation for Y and Z are exactly the same, so let me just show you the steps and you can pause the video if you want to take a closer look. These equations represent the orthographic projection transformation of the position vector from view space to NDC. We want to create a nice matrix out of this, and since we have a scaling factor and an offset for each coordinate, and our position vector has one in the W component, we only need to place the scaling factors along the diagonal and the offsets on the fourth column of the matrix. You can do one of the dot products manually to verify the result. Notice that orthographic projection doesn't include the division by Z, which is a key point in perspective projection. Therefore, we have a 0 instead of 1 in the 4th row and 3rd column because we no longer need to copy the Z into the W component. After multiplying the orthographic projection matrix by the position vector, the W remains 1, so the vector is unaffected by perspective division, which is a step in the pipeline that can't be turned off. And finally, if you want to get a corresponding matrix for a right-handed coordinate system, you just need to develop the equation using negative z instead of positive z. The final result will be that we have to change the numerator of the z scaling factor from a positive 2 to a negative 2, and that's it. You can see the implementation of this matrix in the function init orthoproj transform of the matrix 4F class. This function takes the structure orthoprojinfo as a parameter. It contains 6 variables for the offsets of the view volume faces on their respective axes. If you're using GLM, you can simply call the function ortho in the GLM namespace and pass in the same values. At this stage, it would be a good exercise to switch between perspective and orthographic projection on the existing codebase and make sure the results look similar to what we get in Blender. One thing that may or may not surprise you is that with orthographic projection, it seems like we can't move forward or backward in the 3D world. Remember, no division by Z, no projection. Modifying the shadow mapping demo from the previous tutorial to support directional light doesn't require much work. You can see that in the constructor of the main class, I've changed the spotlight to a directional light. I've also initialized an orthographic projection matrix using the same negative and positive value on all axes. You'll probably want to tune this for each scene so that the view volume is not too large or too small. In order to generate the view matrix in the shadow pass, I've used the origin as the camera, or in this case the light position, and the direction of the light in the world. So this will just create a rotation matrix. This is okay when the scene is centered around the origin, but if you plan to move away from here, you may want to calculate a bounding box for your scene and translate it so that it will be centered around the origin. We'll take a look at this in a future video. And of course, we need to use the orthographic projection matrix to complete the WVP transformation. We do the same changes in the lighting pass, and this is basically it in terms of the main application code. There are no changes in the vertex shader of both the shadow and the lighting pass. And in the fragment shader of the lighting pass, we need to call the same calc shadow factor for the directional light and pass in the result to calc light internal. In the previous video, we disabled this shadow using 1 as the factor, but now it is supported, so there you go. As I told you the last time, there are still many things that can be improved in terms of shadow quality. This of course will be covered in a future video, so make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you won't miss any episode. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.